I'll be real quick, just like the other speakers, because I know it's 9 o'clock and we have to get you out of here by 9:30. Fisheries management, basically it's whatever we can do to change the fishery or manipulate it. So I'm going to talk a little bit about regulation changes that are coming up which affect harvest. I'm going to talk about stocking changes and habitat improvement that's going on. So those are the three main topics, but there's going to be a lot of different categories here. People have been hearing about a new state commercial fishing statute. So I'm going to briefly talk about that. It hasn't been as big a deal in Lake Michigan as it has been in Saginaw Bay. So I'll give you a highlight on that. Talk about some of the habitat improvement we've been doing. Some of it's been real close to here in the Kalamazoo River. Regulation changes coming up. We've got lake trout regs that are going to change, hopefully this year. The stocking changes that happened last year that will be implemented this year and next. Status of our fishery, kind of going from what Chuck already started, and then what our Lake Michigan priorities are for the year and predictions. So here we go. So commercial fishing statute, who has heard that we are rewriting the statute for commercial fishing? So not too bad. If I did this in Bay City, the room would have been up in arms about what's going on with us. Basically, we have a really old statute. It was written in 1929, which governs how commercial fishing works in Michigan. So we really need to change that. It's really outdated. We've been working for 6 years with the state commercial fishers on draft language that could be used to draft a bill. And so that's kind of where we're at with that. This kind of shows how it's just a huge patchwork of amendments throughout the years since 1929. And it's really tough for us to prosecute now if a state commercial fisher is doing something illegally, because a lawyer will look at this and say, and even a judge, and say, we don't know where to look. You've got, you know, 23 amendments on one particular statute. So it really needs changes. And I'm going to run through just a quick list of what needs to change. Basically, the statute is basically a law that says what can be done by state commercial fishers. We have it for sport fishing. So in our sport fishing state law, it basically says you can go out and catch bass. And in the actual statute, it says you cannot keep a bass under 10 inches. But it also, that statute gives the DNR the authority to be more conservative. So if we want to be more conservative with our regulations, we can, and that's why we have a 14-inch size limit on bass now. And that we do that through fish orders, through the director and through the NRC. We don't have that capability with our state commercial fishers now, and we want to be able to do that. The fees are really small. They don't even pay for probably a month worth of work of administrating the program. So the fees have to come up. Fines and penalties are minuscule. We're talking hundreds of dollars of fines, not thousands. If we catch them in poaching or anything, we can't go after them through restitution like we could a sport angler or hunter that's poaching. They don't tell us, you know, where their nets are. They don't have to tell us when they're lost. So this law will help make sure we get that information. It'll help with reporting. Right now, reporting is not very good. With the new law, they're going to have to do electronic reporting, so we get reporting immediately. And that'll help us figure out what they're catching, and also will help law enforcement track the fish to make sure they're being sold and recorded correctly. There'll be a commercial fishing advisory committee, which we don't have, which will help guide harvest rates and changes to fish orders and things. We don't have a list of species that can actually be commercially harvested right now, and we don't have a list that could prohibit certain species, so that will be added. The big thing that's getting everyone's attention right now is there's an allowance of bycatch for lake trout and walleye right now in the statute. Tribal commercial fishers already have that. And what the law would state is that The state commercial fishers could keep up to 100 pounds per net lift of this bycatch. And right now, they can't keep any bycatch. So if they lift up a net, it's got 10 pounds of lake trout in it, and they're dead, they got to throw them overboard. They can't bring them to shore. So we're trying to allow that, get some allowances with that. Now, I mentioned that just because it's in the law doesn't mean that they can do it. We also issue an annual license to each state commercial fisher. So if a walleye population is really low, we could actually state that your bycatch can only be 20 pounds this year, or it can only be 50 pounds this year. It doesn't have to be that 100. So, and this is what people are getting upset at in Saginaw Bay. They don't want any bycatch at all of walleye. So they want all the walleye to be for sport fish. So that is the commercial fishing statute. Moving on, we've had some really good projects for habitat improvement. And one in particular is close by. There's a ripple restoration just below the Allegan Dam on the Kalamazoo River. That was done this past fall. And I actually caught a steelhead on it in November, so just a month or so afterwards. So fish are using it. It was intended to help lake sturgeon, but all species that require rocky habitat should use this ripple. So it's just, you'll notice where it's at if you fish there. It's between the dam and the boat launch. We also finally got the Lions Dam on the Grand River out last summer, and that's the pictures on the bottom. And so that's a free-flowing river system through there. We used to have a fish ladder there so salmon could get through. Now we don't need it at all. Actually, small boats can get through there now. And the other big project that is going on is the Boardman River Dams. The Saban and Boardman Dams should be out, or at least starting to come out by 2018. So that's exciting for that system. And we have a new research program in collaboration with the Great Lakes Fish Commission and U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service to put a selective fish passage research station there, where we're going to try new techniques to pass fish besides our traditional fish ladder. Something that will pass suckers, sturgeon if you want, walleye, but won't pass sea lamp or your things you don't want. So that's some exciting research that's going to go on in Traverse City. I point out habitat improvement because you saw Matt show all the wild fish we have coming out of our Michigan streams, and we've been huge for many years concentrating on habitat improvement by removing our dams and connecting our river systems. That's why we're getting wild chinook, that's why we're getting wild steelhead, that's why we're getting more walleye coming up our rivers. The other states haven't been as aggressive with that or don't have the river miles that we do. So the wild fish, there's a part reason for that, cleaner water and better habitat. So regulation changes. A couple of things going on. There's been a lot of chatter about changing our bag limit for chinook salmon. I shouldn't say a lot, a little bit of chatter. Enough that we're going to bring it up at the Citizens Advisors meeting next week. And that would be whether we're going to change from a 5-fish bag limit back to 3. And right now that's tied to our predator prey ratio. And basically anytime we're in a stocking reduction like we are now, we want to keep harvest high so we take the pressure off the prey. We're trying to reduce predation now. So biologically we should keep this in place, but anglers are starting to not even catch 3 a trip and they're wondering, well, why do we have a 5-fish bag limit? So there could be some pressure to change that. This year for all of 2017 it will be 5. 2018, I got a question mark in case it gets some legs and gets changed. We are right now within the Natural Resource Commission, there's a changing the size limit of lake trout from 15 inches down to 15 inches in a 2-fish bag. And this is up in Traverse City area, northern part of Lake Michigan, but right now there's a weird type of slot limit there. So we're trying to make it a little more simple and reducing the size limit there. And for the rest of the lake down here, we're looking to open the lake trout season all year. So there will no longer be a closed season on that. That's in the NRC right now. I think they should sign it and it will be taken immediate effect sometime in June. So this fall, you can basically continue to fish lake trout, you know, all through the winter. So that'll be good for the pier fishermen that sometimes catch them in the close season. Our Drum River Bluff lakes will also open up. So this would be like the lower Grand, Muskegon, White Lake, Mona Lake, Lower Kalamazoo Lake. Those will all be open all year for lake trout as well. So stocking. Last year I was here, you know, starting to introduce a stocking plan. At that point, the Lake Michigan Committee was looking at 62% reduction in shuck salmon. And that was basically because we had low prey levels. We're trying to reduce predation. You saw the bioenergetics information and how much Chinook eat in just a few years. So we were concentrating on Chinook to get a quick change. We didn't communicate it very well, and we got hammered last summer by sport anglers. So we adjusted throughout the summer, and this is the plan that we came up with, and this is lakewide. So it'd be a 24% reduction in Chinook. And that's all the states except Wisconsin reduced Chinook. A 24% reduction in brown trout, and that's all coming out of Wisconsin. 18% reduction in lake trout, that's all the states contributing. 3% reduction in steelhead out of Wisconsin, and a 2% in coho, which came out of Michigan. So Michigan's plan is to stock 330,000 Chinook. So we actually took a 41% reduction. But remember that we have 70% of our catch is wild. The brown trout, steelhead are the same, and the coho is a 96% reduction. From what we had, or excuse me, 96,000 reduction than what we had. And then we reduced 80,000 out of our southern ports for lake trout. And then we continue to stock 50,000 lake trout from our state fish hatcheries. And we're planning on reducing that or eliminating that by 2018 and possibly replacing those with steelhead. So I'm going to show you where we're going to plan on stocking Chinook salmon. We came up with a new idea for Chinook because 330,000 doesn't go very far anymore, and most of those fish are going to our Little Manistee Weir, our Little Manistee River, because that's where we take our eggs. So putting 10,000 or 20,000 fish per port just didn't make much sense, because you get to a point where there's a threshold that we think it's because of predation. You need to get over a predator threshold to make a stocking worthwhile. We thought at least 30,000, if not better, 50,000 at a particular stocking site is what you need to get decent survival. So where we decided to put our Chinook this year is basically we need an egg take operation. So that was one of our main priorities. We wanted to stock fish away from where we have wild fish contributions, so more to the south for the most part, and some in the UP. We wanted to, based on tagging, stock where we know we contribute to lakewide fishery, and then where there's a potential for a fall fishery, where we have a river system like a Grand or the St. Joe that's connected to cities upstream by fish ladders, so many people have an opportunity to catch fall fish. And we're trying to keep net spend partnerships as well. So this is what we were doing last year, and this is the plan for this year. We actually bumped up the Little Manistee River stocking by 30,000. We basically were hitting, we're getting pretty low returns there, so we want to make sure we get better returns. And then we'll put 50,000 at Medusa. Medusa's up by Charlevoix. It's been one of our index sites since the 90s, so we're trying to maintain that index site. And older tagging data suggested that Medusa was a good contributor to the overall lakewide fishery. Now, more recent data, it's more sporadic, or some years it's decent, some years it's not. It's we're not sure why that is yet. This year we're going to put 50,000 at Grand Haven. Those were intended to go in a net pen, but the river's really high, and I think we're going to direct plant those because the river's got too much debris in it right now. And then St. Joe's and getting at 50,000. If we continue with this pulse type stocking, we'd go to different locations basically in 2018. Going to the Manistee in UP, Boardman in Traverse City, South Haven, and then Saugatuck. So that would be our plan for Chinook stocking, at least in the near future. Maybe hard to read there. There's been a lot of talk about lake trout and where we're stocking them. We basically had to work through a lot of issues with the other states in trying to get a lake trout reduction. As a result of that, Michigan is going to be accepting this year an extra 300,000 lake trout on the mid-lake reef just across the state line. So they're still going to be out in the middle of the lake, but we're moving them, and that was to help Wisconsin out with their issues there. But if you look at what we've been stocking, this is Michigan's total stocking of lake trout. This is what we have been stocking, about 2.2 million. And we're going to be stocking about 2.3 million just for 2017 because we're taking on those extra fish. But by 2018, we're going to be back down to 2.1. Most of those fish now are all going up in the northern refuge. So Matt had talked about how the high mortality is up there. What was it, 79% or something like that? Really high mortality there because of commercial fishing and because of sea lamprey. And that's, so we really need to get the adult population up there so we can start to see some natural reproduction. So that's why most of the stocking is going up in that location. MM4 is Traverse City area, Traverse Bay, that'll be getting 340,000. MM5 is like Arcadia area, and then MM6 is Ludington, Manistee, and basically we're not going to have any nearshore lake trout stocking south of Ludington under this plan. Reason for that, we're seeing fish move off the mid-lake reef near shore. We're seeing more natural reproduction in the south, so we're gonna see how this rolls. What are the other states doing? Wisconsin, Mid-Lake Refuge, they have been stocking 600,000. It's going to go to 300,000. The other locations are going to be eliminated. Illinois is going to continue to stock the Illinois reef in the south, and Indiana is going to eliminate their nearshore stock. So altogether, we're going to go from 3.1 million to 2.54 million in lake trout. This is what we produce out of our own hatchery, our Marquette hatchery that goes to the Grand Holland and New Buffalo, and these will be eliminated after 2018 and hopefully replaced with steelhead. Coho, I mentioned we reduced that a little bit. The 96,000 is coming out of all the other locations besides the Platte. Platte's where we get our eggs. We're going to hold that the same. It results in like a 12.5% reduction for the other sites. So I'm going to get into just show kind of where the fishery is right now. And before I did that, I just wanted to let you know what kind of objectives we've had. Last year we were accused, all the states were, of trying to drive this fishery down to just a lake trout fishery. That we were trying to eliminate Chinook salmon and only have lake trout. And that's completely not the case. This fish community objective was established back in the 1980s. It basically states that we want a diverse salmon community of salmon and trout, and only 20 to 25% of the harvest would be lake trout. So even back then, we did not want this. And this has tribal representation on it as well, 5 tribes and the 4 states came up with this. So we're not trying to drive the system to be a lake trout only. We're really trying to balance what we have. And what we're doing with our stocking reduction is really to try to achieve this, to try to maintain a diverse prey species population that's matched with the primary production out there and predator demand. You saw Chuck mentioned several times in his talk, we have too many predators. We have too many predators. And we're trying to make those reductions now. And the main prey that we're trying to save right now is alloy, which is really low. We have some other objectives. These are more for Michigan's side. Our citizens advisors came up with some objectives back in 2012, which helped us decide stocking reductions in 2013. They wanted to see decent catch rates of 8 to 12 fish per hour, and this is Chinook. Maintain a diverse fishery of greater than 50% Chinook, so that's a good one. Good growth, at least 15 pounds for H3 fish. Keep alloy to below undesirable levels. Alloy, when they're really high, cause problems with our native species, so we don't want them to totally explode, but we need a lot more than what we have now. And then have adequate spawning stock biomass of lake trout. And that's, once we have that, we'll start to see more natural reproduction of lake trout. So that's kind of our objectives. I'm gonna go through kind of where we're at on different things. Sea lamprey came up earlier, and there's really good news about sea lamprey in Lake Michigan. We're meeting our targets finally. For many years, we were not. And this was affecting the lake trout population in the northern part of the lake. This was mostly coming from the Manistee River in the UP. They found their way through a broken down dam there, and sea lamprey were spawning in that. Once that was discovered, U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service really started to treat that system hard, and we've basically driven the population down to below targets for the first time in many years. The other thing I wanted to mention is that Muskegon River, if you fish the Muskegon, it's going to be treated this year. Probably August, September time frame, so just be aware of that. Muskegon and Manistee are two of the other big systems that contribute to most of the sea lamprey in Lake Michigan. We talk a lot about the predator-prey model. I wish I could show the actual model results right now, but we had some changes. We did some changes to the model over the winter, and some of the outputs were a little bit different than we expected, and we're trying to make sure that we understand what was going on there. But I will say that the latest model run was 0.073. So we've come down from that critical mark when we were above 10, that high line. So things look a little bit better. I can share some of the basic information that goes into that model, and that's the biomass of age one Chinook, which is up here. So we remember the 2012 days when everything was great. We had a lot of salmon out there that's come down. That's the good news, is we have a little bit of an uptick with our age one Chinook, so that's good news. Bad news is alloy biomass continues to be down. The new model run, rather than falling fairly rapid, it actually smoothed out a little bit. So that's the good news of this year, is that we're kind of leveling on instead of diving down completely. So a little bit of optimism of things maybe changing. Other things we can look at is age of female Chinook. So if fish are growing, they're finding something to eat, right? Last year when we made this decision to cut stocking, it was based on 2015 data. We were way down here. And that's a scary place to be. Kind of the stated goal was about 15 pounds. 2016, we jumped up. And you all recognize that with the larger size Chinook out there. So that's good news. What's concerning, though, is this constant up and down and drastic changes. So that tells me there's instability compared to what we had back here. Another thing we can look at, and it's an important thing about getting stomachs, is looking at the percent of empty stomachs. So it's bad when you have a lot of fish with empty stomachs, means they're not eating anything. This information is just from Michigan DNR, so it doesn't include the other states. So you kind of got to put an asterisk on this, but it maybe explains, you know, what your fishery was like over here. The Chinook just weren't finding the bait as they were in Wisconsin. If you did the same study in Wisconsin, it may have been a little bit different, but on the Michigan side, our Chinooks, we had the most empty stomachs since this time series. So kind of explains, you know, bait was on the other side of the lake for whatever reason. But to go to Dan's program that he started to evaluate diets, that's why we need to have empty stomachs as well as with fish in them or bait in the stomachs, because we need to understand this as well. Catch per hour, the goal was around 8.08 to 12, which is around this line. So our catch per hour was actually within the stated goal, but definitely not what you remember in recent history. We were up to, you know, 3 per hour, which is 0.3 per hour, which is pretty big. And then one of the last things is the percent of your catch, and this is lake-wide, and we wanted to maintain Chinook as 50% of the catch, and that's pretty close to what we were last year. You know, we've been sliding down. We were spoiled here when it was 80%. Now we're getting down to that 50, and hopefully we'll flatten out. Not quite as bad as the BKD days when we were down about 30%. And despite people thinking we're catching tons of lake trout, I mean, it's not quite as much as we were in the 90s in terms of percentage of your catch, but it is increasing. And then Chuck touched on this, and this is just the age structure of alewife. This is what it was before, and the main point is that we had older ages, more older ages, and now we have very few in these older age groups. So we need to get these younger fish spawning and surviving so we can help the age structure of the alewife. So wrapping up, what's Lake Michigan Committee going to work on this year? We're going to continue to try to balance the predator-prey abundance in Lake Michigan, so continue to look at it. People challenged us a lot about what each species was eating, whether you're lake trout, Chinook, brown trout, steelhead. So the diet work is going to be essential to do that. We're also trying to improve our models to estimate lake trout, especially in the southern part of the lake. We've got a group looking at the nutrients in the lake and then helping us figure out what could those nutrients then support for prey. Once we know that, then we know, okay, we have this much prey available. What can that support for predators? And that can help guide us as well in terms of managing our predators. For lake trout rehabilitation, we've got a group looking at when we can start pulling back on lake trout stocking, when we're starting to meet those rehabilitation goals. And we definitely are starting to do that in the southern part of the lake. But we're gonna be watching that close in the northern part of the lake. We're going to continue to look at our fish community objectives and hopefully improve on those. We're also creating habitat priority areas for Lake Michigan. Predictions, I think you're going to see more age 1 and 2 Chinook salmon out there. And that's because the 3s and 4s will probably be less abundant than what you've seen or remember catching in years past. That's because of the poor 2013 and 14 year classes. We did see some alewife production in 15 and 16, but like Chuck said, it was still below average. But in recent history, I thought they were pretty good. So if their survival is good, then that's good news. Brown trout seem to be a little bit better, not as good as I thought it would be this year, but there are some browns being caught. Steelhead numbers are good. And the fish are much bigger this year. Coho should be good. It sounds like they are. They're still catching them out deep eating mysis, but they are catching a few inshore as well. And we're watching our Cisco population. It's expanding out of Grand Traverse Bay. I wouldn't be surprised if we see some caught around Grand Haven this year. Ludington was about the furthest south I saw them last year. And that's it for me. And this is a really nice size steelhead caught all the way up in past East Lansing in the Red Cedar River. So These fish do produce good fisheries all the way up into those areas, and the fish ladders do work. So I will take some questions.